Hi everyone and welcome to the Course Correct podcast. If you're new here, my name is Amog, I'm a would-be MBA student. I'm going to be joining the Indian School of Business this year and I want to revolutionize the way you think about your careers. This episode is part of a season on Anchor Subjects, where we take a journey through a subject, explore all the possible career options and how to get there. The Anchor Subjects season playlist is tagged in the top right-hand corner right about now. Check it out. This episode, we're going to be focusing on art. I'm going to be telling you why art is so great, why you should be excited about an art-based career, my top 10 list of careers that have art as their focal point, a couple of unconventional careers that you wouldn't think are tailor-made for art-based graduates and people who are interested and passionate about art, and what you can do starting today to get your passion for art bubbling up again. I've included timestamps for all of these in the show notes as well as in this video, so you can feel free to skip around as you feel like it. For now, let's get started. So, what do artists achieve? What does art accomplish in this world? Right away, wrong question. That's not the question you should be asking. The reason you shouldn't be asking that question is because that is not the question that defines art and artists. Here are the questions that might define art and artists. Who are they? Where do they come from? What makes them create? And how come it comes out so good? I mean, which is not to say that art and artists don't achieve anything. The greatest art in the world is valued at hundreds of millions of dollars. The greatest art and the greatest artists in the world have widely been known as toppling power structures, becoming the best in their day, becoming intellectual and moral and artistic elite. But that's not the point of art, is it? So here is the best way I have ever heard the value of art described. And it comes from clinical psychologist Jordan Peterson. Art is valuable because the hitherto unknown shines out at us from it in partially articulated form. So artists have to contend with the unknown continuously. They are contending with the unknown, reaching their hands deep into the unknown and the unconscious, pulling out some seed of wisdom and splotching it on a canvas so that we look at it in horror and awe and incredulousness and think to ourselves, man, how did they come up with that? So let's talk about the role that artists play in society. I'm going to walk you guys through four. Role number one, to beautify. Now obviously you must be thinking, oh, okay, to beautify, just make something pretty. No, that's not what I'm talking about. That's not even remotely what creative people do. Here's what creative people really do. They take ineffable emotions and bring them from the subconscious to the conscious for all of us to look at and marvel at. Let me ask you this. Do you know what happiness looks like? Maybe you have a sense, you maybe know what sadness looks like. Do you know what childlike wonder looks like? How about bliss? How about fear? How about longing? They take these emotions, artists, they take these emotions and splotch them on a canvas or on a picture or in a sculpture. They make us understand what these emotions are. They make us look at it. They make us confront the image and ourselves and make all the emotions beautiful and magnificent and worthy of appreciation. That's what they do. They don't just make things pretty. Which brings me to my next point. Role number two, to connect. Art can be used as a vehicle to express collective emotion. Yes, art obviously can connect you to higher truths, but art does a little bit more than that. Art can also connect you to universal emotion. Artists have this knack of feeling strongly. They can absorb the vibe of a place. They have this knack of remembering the memory of a feeling and splotching it on a canvas so that all of us can see something that you pulled out of the subconscious into the conscious. And look at it. That's what they do. That's what artists can do. That's what art can do. Most of us, like me, block out emotion. Therefore, when an artist shows me something that I maybe don't want to see, maybe something that I have deeply buried in my subconscious, but the artist brings it out into the conscious level and makes me feel an emotion, That's the artist doing their job very well. Let me give you an example. During World War II in the United States, there was a lot of anger and a lot of pain directed straight at Hitler. People thought Hitler was the worst person ever to live on the face of the earth, and they wanted to annihilate him. I mean, obviously, even now, people still want to annihilate the old Hitler, but I mean, that's a separate issue. I'm saying that there was a lot of anger and a lot of pain. Here was the artwork that really resonated with people. This is literally a picture that shows Captain America punching Hitler in the face. The reason that that picture is so iconic is because it resonated with a lot of people. It was a vehicle that was expressing collective emotion. And that is why it became so popular. And that is one of the fundamental reasons why Captain America is such a big Marvel superhero, even to this day. Rule number three, to speak the truth. Now, artists are inherently capable of showing the truth of society on a canvas and changing the world through it. Here's an example. Actually, here's a couple of examples. NGO marketing and climate change marketing. Take a look. I'm showing some pictures to you on the screen right now. The reason these marketing campaigns are so visceral and so effective is because it shows the truth of a situation. Climate change is so much more than just a polar bear on an ice cap. The reason that is such a powerful image is because it shows you what exactly is happening and where the world is going. The same thing happens with an NGO. Now, if the NGO is about starvation or hunger, the faces paint the picture. If the NGO is about maybe a pet shelter, then the faces of the pets and the pictures and the art paints that picture for you. And a picture, as they say, is worth a thousand words. And that's why people always use art. A visual medium communicates the visceral nature of the truth. And sometimes that's what you need. Rule number four, to tell a story. Now, a couple of reasons why you might want to tell a story: to entertain, to instruct. And this is a literature stomping ground, I agree. But there are a couple of times when art can tell the story even better than literature can. And here are a couple of examples. First example is children's books. Children, you want to have a visual connect between the word and the picture. That's the point of a children's book. Therefore, art is perfect. Here is the second example, comic books. I can wax poetic about a war and what happened in a war until the cows come home. Show me a better way than a hero punching a villain in the face with the words BAMF written all over it. Show me a better way than that to show what exactly happened. And here is another example. Dante Alighieri wrote an epic ballad of a poem. He called it the Divine Comedy. It was one of the greatest pieces of literature of its time, and it was loved by everybody. But Botticelli's work, where it shows the nine circles of hell, takes it to another level. Let me explain. Dante Alighieri, in that epic poem, shows how he went through the circles of hell, and there were nine circles of hell, and what he found at each level. Botticelli's work made that a visceral image that you could see. After that, the Divine Comedy and its representation of hell was taken to a whole new level. It was a truth. Literature showed that truth. Art took that truth to a whole new level. That's what art can do, even with literature. A truth-telling medium in its own right. That's how awesome art is. Now, the next thing I'm going to be talking to you guys about is the people. What are the role models you should be having in your journey to become a better artist? Now, the most obvious examples are the greatest artists of all time: Leonardo da Vinci, Vincent van Gogh, Michelangelo, Edward Munch, Monet. These are the best artists in the world, and you should really know their work. But there are some more people that you should be taking inspiration from. The best comic book artists out there. Brian Bolland. Now, you may not know who Brian Bolland is, but he's responsible for the most iconic image in the DC ethos. And here it is. Everyone remembers this picture. Brian Bolland is the guy responsible for it. Here's another. Jack Kirby. In his time, Jack Kirby came up with the Fantastic Four, the Hulk, and Captain America. He was the guy who drew them for the first time. He was an incredible artist. You should know about him. In the same breath, I'm going to say Steve Ditko. Steve Ditko came up with Doctor Strange. You remember all that great imagery in the Doctor Strange Marvel film? He was the guy who put it on paper for the first time. Yes, you remember this image.
Open your eyes. What mysteries lie beyond the reach of your senses? Filled with malice and hunger.
But this image is the one that I want you to remember, because that is the guy who came up with it. That is the image that you should remember. Here's another, Abhijit Kinney. You should really know about this guy. He is very, very famous in the Indian comic book space, and he came up with one of the most iconic Indian comic book characters of all time, Angry Maushi. It's an amazing character. You should really know about Angry Maushi. I'm going to be listing the website in the description. Go through it. You should really know who Angry Maushi is. Apart from comic book artists, you should think of designers as one of your role models. Jony Ive, the head of design at Apple, the iPhone, the iPad, the MacBook, all designed under his direction. Philippe Starck, I'm going to be linking his website in the description. He made some of the most iconic designs in the 20th century. Here's another name, Dilip Chhabria. Dilip Chhabria, or DC, came up with the Avanti car, which is the most cutting edge of style that has ever been seen in a mass-produced car in India. And here is my favorite designer, Vijay Singh Ajay Rajpura of Rajputana Customs. Here is his work. Now, this guy has taken a passion project of being in love with old style bikes and made it into a profession of modifying normal mass produced today's bikes into old style bikes. And only he can make them look like that. The reason only he can make them look like that is because he is the person who has the vision and the execution power and the years of experience behind him to make them into the monsters that they are. He's a great designer. You should know about his work. After the people, it's on to the broader meaning of the subject, the legacy that the subject is leaving and is resting on your shoulders. The first way I can describe it is to depict the nature of something, to shine a bright light. Just like the examples I gave before of climate change marketing or NGO marketing, any visual branding of any sort is what takes an issue or a brand or something that you want to shine a bright light on and using art to bring it to the fore. One of the most subtle ways in which this works is typefaces, fonts that are used to put across emotion. There are some fonts that are formal, some fonts that are casual. You may never use a Comic Sans in order to write a formal email. You might never use Times New Roman if you want to write in a comic book. Maybe even you would if there was a particularly formal character talking. It is the best way of explaining what the letter or what the content is about is by making sure you have the right font for it. That is how powerful visual branding is. That is how you can shine a bright light in the subtlest of ways. Here's another way of saying it. To make something that will outlive us all. Every one of us, if we are artists, wants to make the Sistine Chapel, wants to make the Mona Lisa, wants to make the Scream, wants to make the David. You want to be this person that creates something that is so touching and so enigmatic and so out there and so incredible that it stands the test of time. And the only reason that we know artists is because they created something that stood the test of time. We know Leonardo da Vinci because he made the Mona Lisa. So many of us know Michelangelo because he created the David. So many of us know Edvard Munch because he made the Scream. It is because of the works of art that they created that they will outlive all of us. Even after 300 years of being alive themselves. Now, another way to think about it is just to express yourself. Just to infuse a little bit of yourself into pop culture. Now, any art form where form follows function is a great example of this. Just think about Louis H. Sullivan's work, the great modern architect, the starter of the modern architect movement. The rise of skyscrapers is in no small part because of Louis H. Sullivan's work. Think about product design, one of the best product designs that I can imagine where someone has infused themselves into culture is the Barca Lounger. Think about it, it's just a chair. The reason that chair exists is because the function of that chair is to allow you to never leave the chair again. That's the function of that chair. And the form follows that function perfectly. And the person who invented the Barca Lounger has cemented a place for themselves in the culture because they invented the Barca Lounger. That is how they expressed themselves and how they infused themselves into the culture. That is one of the greatest broader meanings of art. Now, after the broader meaning, it is down to the day-to-day Zen moments. I mean, broader meaning is great and all, but what can I think of day-to-day that will make me want to get out of bed and go to work? Every single day. That's what we're going to be talking about right now. The first Zen moment is constant conversations with creative, artistic individuals. If you're an artist, you should crave this. You should crave wanting to talk to people who make you better artists, who you can learn from, who make you a better person, who make you see perspective, who make you see a whole new way of looking at things, who make you want to work harder, who motivate you and who inspire you. And that will be one of the main things that you will find solace in as an artist. Here's another Zen moment if you get into the more design aspect of it all. Deconstructing a brief or ideation. Now, if I come to you and say, design me a wallet. Design me a wallet for the 21st century. I mean, we'll get to the best electric planes, we'll get to the best motorcycles, and we'll get to the hoverboard in just a minute. Design me a wallet. Design me something that will take the 21st century by storm and be the best wallet out there. What would you do? What would you think about? Will you integrate the new payment technologies that there are? Would you take a look at the kind of things that a wallet is supposed to do? Would you rethink what a wallet even does? Would you try to amalgamate what wallets are with other things that people carry in their pockets all the time? Would you take a look at all of it from first principles and make me something that is truly revolutionary? Are you interested in something like that? Does this excite you? Maybe that tells you that you want to be an artist. Art is awesome. Now, on to the next thing. Here are my top 10 art-related careers. Now, disclaimer, this is my top 10 list. I like this list. The reason I like this list is because I have done my research and I think this top 10 list gives you the best touch point to art and gives you the best shot at keeping your creative juices flowing every single day. Maybe I've missed something. Let me know. Put it down in the comments. I'll take a look at it in the future episodes. But you have to do your research as well. You have to take a look and figure out what is the best way of keeping in touch with art that you can come up with. Do your own research, find your own answer. This is just my list. See if it works for you. Let's get going. Number one, fashion designer. Now, this is a fairly obvious one in the design space. It continues to keep your creative juices flowing all day long. Do you want to be a part of the Gucci's and Armani's of the world? Do you want to be a part of Christian Dior? Do you want to be a part of Myntra or Jabong? Do you want to be a part of Nike or Adidas designing sportswear? All of these things are available to you if you are a fashion designer. There are great institutes out there that can teach you every facet of how clothes and shoes and watches and everything that everyone wears are made, are designed, and are manufactured and are brought to the customers, and how that product life cycle works and who can really contribute to it. You can be considered as one of the foremost leaders in the fashion industry if you're into art, if you're really passionate about apparel or shoes and what it is that you want to design. And you could be really great at it. I would sincerely take a look at this industry if you're into art. Number two, a graphic designer or an illustrator. Now, good graphic designers and illustrators are very hard to find. they do most of the artwork for all of the big brands out there. Think about it. They make the logo, they make the posters, they make all the artwork for any big ad campaign that they will ever see out there. If you're an illustrator, you might even animate, you might even do storyboarding for big ads that are shown in big ad campaigns for the biggest brands in the world. Think about Amul. Think about the biggest brands and the biggest ad campaigns that you have ever seen. Do you want to be a part of them? Do you want to design logos for the biggest brands in the world? Do you want to be part of an ad agency or a marketing consultancy that can do this job where you will be able to make the logo for the biggest brand out there and be a part of their success story? Maybe then this job is for you. Number three, an architect or an interior designer. Now, an architect designs buildings. An interior designer designs the homes or the office spaces within them. Now, how big do you want your art to be? Do you want it to be as big as a home? Do you want it to be as big as a building? Do you want it to be as big as a township? These professions can get you there. You can build a home, you can build an office space, you can be a part of the journey of a family to move into their own home. If you're an interior designer, you can be a part of a builder's dream to make a building and design something that will stand the test of time, that will quite literally outlive us all, simply because it will be etched into the ground and will stand until someone breaks it down. It is a great profession to look at if you're interested in the world around you, if you want to plan something and execute something that will be part of the skyline of a city. And it's a profession that you should really think about if you're interested in art. Number four, a product designer. Now, this is my personal favorite. How good are you at deconstructing a brief? How good are you at being able to give something that people don't even know that they want? Now, here is a classic example, the iPhone. People didn't even know that they wanted it. Now they want it so much that every phone is a clone of the iPhone. Everyone has an iPhone, basically, because everyone has continued to just use that technology, and that technology has basically permeated into our existence. You could make consumer goods. Everything from food to electronics has a packaging, has a design of the product that goes along with it, and there are people who are designing each and every aspect of it. You could make automobiles. Every individual car design comes from one person and one team. You could be a part of that team. You could be a part of a team that is designing cars every day. If you're into something more elegant, then maybe you could be a jewelry designer. There are always people looking for the most beautiful piece of jewelry out there. And there is always a designer behind all of them. On the more technology end of things, maybe you could be one of the people who designs websites or phone apps. Every single click that comes from my laptop or my phone or my tablet that goes into each one of my phone applications or websites are thought through and are designed by people who want to make sure that you either buy something in the case of Amazon, or click on something in the case of Facebook, or let's say like a photo or share a photo when it comes to Instagram. Each individual website design caters to their audience in very specific ways, and it is only the designers who know the workings behind it and why it has been designed like that. You could be a part of one of these stories. It's a great way of spending your career. I would seriously look into it. Number five, you could be an animator. Now, animator is sort of an umbrella term. Animator covers everything from this to this. So stick with us, cause Phineas and Ferb
are gonna do it all. Mom! Phineas and Ferb are making a title sequence!
To this. Now think about each of these separately. Do you want to be one of the people who brings Marvel movies to life? Do you want to be an animator in Marvel movies or DC movies or all of the other great movies that are going to be using CGI to their benefit? Or do you want to be a cartoonist? Do you want to be a part of getting the best animated movies to the big screen? Do you want to be a part of getting the How to Train Your Dragon series on the screen? Do you want to be a part of getting Inside Out on the screen? Do you want to be a part of maybe getting Onward on the screen? It's a great experience. Maybe you will be a part of telling the best stories in the world. Maybe you want to be a cartoonist. Or you could be a video game designer. Do you want to be a part of getting the next FIFA out? How about the next Half-Life game? How about the next Dota? How about the next Call of Duty? How about the next Injustice game? Which of these games do you love? Do you want to be a part of designing one of these games? You have to be into art. You don't actually have to be into art just to design video games, but if you're into art, one of the best things you can do is to design video games. Take a look into it. Number 6, a comic book artist or a storyboard artist? Now, the only difference between these two is that one of them makes books and the other one makes movies. Both of them do the exact same job in their respective divisions. Do you want to be a part of making the best comic books out there? Do you want to be a part of making this and this and this? How about that? Maybe you should be a comic book artist if you're into all of that. Or maybe you can be a storyboard artist. All of us maybe remember this. What we don't realize that actually this is where it started.
But first, before we do the play, I'd like to talk about the very serious subject of schizophrenia.
No, it doesn't. Shut up, let him talk.
Once again, if there are any little children here tonight, we've used these words in a sentence.
Every big movie that is animated starts at the storyboard. The reason it starts at the storyboard is that is where the story is born. That is where the story is made and figured out. That is where a storyboard artist comes in. And that is the person who designs the storyboard, who designs the work, who designs the architecture of what the scenes look like, and designs the way the story progresses and how it looks when the story progresses the way it does. It's a great profession. You should think about it. Number 7. And here is an interesting one. Art historian or museum curator or a conservation technician. Now, all of these people will be working in museums, just in different capacities. An art historian might be working for a private art collector, might be feeding them information into what pieces of art to buy and what pieces of art to let go, based on the fact that they know what good art is. They know how to segregate good art from bad art. Then you've got the museum curator and the conservation technician. Both of these people will work at the museum. The museum curator, along with the trust that works and maintains the museum, will make sure that you know and you have the best pieces in that museum so that that museum can become a great tourist attraction and a great place to store the best art in the world. In order to make sure that the best art of our time and all time always stays in that museum, and that museum attracts the best crowd. The conservation technician, on the other hand, is going to be in charge of making sure that the art pieces always look perfect and last the longest. Yes, the Mona Lisa is one of the best pieces of art of all time. You want to make sure that as many people as physically possible can take a look at the actual Mona Lisa. That is the reason that you need conservation technicians. They use a host of different skills to make sure that the art that has moved a generation of people can be conserved and put up in a museum so that all of the future generations, as many as we can possibly have, can view that piece of art and understand how great and how influential these people were because of their work. Number 8, a photographer or a cinematographer. If you're into art, chances are you'd be pretty good at photography and cinematography. One of them are still pictures, the other are videos. Everything from shooting a landscape to shooting a safari, everything from taking a picture of a bride to shooting the entire wedding, and everything from taking a portrait of someone to shooting an entire movie requires these people to to work for you. How is the lighting? How is the shot? Is the shot blocked well? Is it an interesting way of taking the viewer on a journey with the subjects, the content, to make sure that someone will look at it and really be moved? All of these questions have to be answered by the photographers and the cinematographers. These are the questions that are technical in nature. These are the questions that have to be answered by these people because they are the right people with the right kind of skills to answer that question. If you're into art, I think you would be a very good fit for these roles. Which brings me to number 9, and this is a related one, editor. Yes, you could be a photographer and a cinematographer, and you could be in charge of producing content, or you could also be in charge of editing and post-producing content. Once the content is produced, it just gets mailed to the editor, and the editor's job is to sit in a room by themselves and edit it to make it into the final product that we see in front of us. It takes a great eye for detail. It takes a real amount of skills to be able to add layer after layer after layer to make sure that every piece of this art is shown to you in the best possible way. And it takes a great level of thoroughness and diligence to get to be an editor of any repute. It's a great job if you have the inclination for it. If you're into art and you're really detail oriented, being an editor might be the thing for you. Number 10, an art teacher. Now, personally, I think this is the most important thing you can do with an interest in the arts. If you have been blessed with a talent, I think it is one's responsibility to share it with the world and tell as many people about it as possible so that the talent itself lives on. It is really important, if you have been blessed with the arts, for you to teach everyone what creativity is all about, how you can unlock your imagination and live a better life because you are humbled by all the things that have been achieved by everyone else and all of the things you can achieve if you just get out of your own way. This is in fact the most important thing you can do, in my opinion, with an arts education or with an arts interest. Please, take a look at it if you're really into arts. And that's it. That's my top 10 list. On to the next thing. Now, here are a couple of unconventional careers that I think are tailor-made for art graduates. This is the section I like to call, I can do that. Number 1. You remember how I said product design? What are the most outrageous products you can think of? I can think of 2. The first one, do you want to be one of the people who designs Ferraris? Do you want to be one of the people who designs Teslas? Here is the most mind-boggling thing about this. Elon Musk has always said that the road that Tesla will take is to make its cars cheaper and cheaper. He made the Roadster, which was around $200,000. Then he made the Model S, which is around $60,000 to $70,000. Then he made the Model X, which was a little bit of a step up. Then he made the Model 3, which is around $40,000, $45,000, something like that. He has always said that he wants to make a sub $10,000 car for mainly the Indian market, because the Indian market is the real market where a lot of fossil fuel work has to be done to get us rid of all the fossil fuels. That's what he wants to do. Do you want to be a part of that? Do you want to be one of the people who designs that car? It's possible. What are some of the more outrageous things you could design? Keep thinking. Do you want to design roller coasters? Do you want to design all the amazing roller coasters that you see in Imagica? Do you want to design all of the amazing roller coasters that you might see in Disneyland, for example? Disneyland has an actual position. The position is called a Disney Imagineer. I'm going to be linking it down in the description. Take a look at this position. This position is literally a mechanical engineer who designs a roller coaster and an artist who designs a roller coaster. It is an incredible opportunity. This is something that no one knows exists, but everyone wants to do. Do you want to do it? Maybe you should really be into art. Maybe you should really focus on it. just so that you could do this for a living. Number two, work for the 3M innovation team. Now I'm going to be linking a case in the description about 3M. Take a look at it. 3M has two teams, an innovation team and an activation team. This is very different from most design companies or even most manufacturing companies. The innovation team is just set free. They work on very different timelines and they work in very different hierarchies as the activation team. The innovation team, what they do is they just come up with ideas. They've been given briefs and they have to just come up with ideas. 3M has designed post-it notes. 3M has designed the mask that all of us are wearing during this terrible time. 3M designed sellotape. 3M has actually designed double-sided tape in order to solve the problem of sticking things onto walls. I have used that sellotape here. It is a model that is impossible to replicate. It is a model that has only worked for that company, and it is because it puts design thinking over everything else. Do you want to be a part of that journey? Do you want to witness people making something so basic that it becomes a part of culture without you even realizing it? Maybe art is for you. Here is another unconventional thing you could do. Mozart. This is a friend of a friend, and they're doing some amazing work. They run a training program where they run team bonding exercises and they run self-exploratory exercises through music and through art. It is run by two people, Rishabh Mehta and Sanjay Ajmera. I've linked the website down below. Take a look at it. Their case is actually very interesting. Do you want to be a part of that company? Now you're into art. Now what? What can you do today? That's what this next part is going to be about. Here's where I walk through a few things that maybe you can use to get your interest and your passion for art bubbling up again, and it will inspire you to do more and understand more and learn more and maybe even be a better artist and a better person. Let's get going. Here's the first thing I think you should do. Have new experiences. Create a bank of visuals. Now, creating a bank of visuals doesn't always mean going to Spain on a bachelor trip and going into the streets of Barcelona at night during sunset so that you can see the light shining on the roads and all of that. You could explore some new courses. You could learn a few new things. You could understand different patterns. You could even scroll Instagram. Just see the artists on Instagram and the things that they're doing. Looking up some intelligent and some really artistic artwork can give you that inspiration to have that bank of visuals to come back to every single time when you want to create a piece of art for yourself. That is something that you can do every day starting today. Number two, this one's on Netflix. Watch Abstract. This is a really, really, really incredible series that I really encourage you to watch if you're the slightest bit interested in art or even if you're not. Abstract lays out the different foundations of where art comes from and the different places where art finds application. It is the best series and it explains art in a way that even someone like me, who is not very good at art, can understand it. It's a great place to start, and I would highly encourage you to take a look at it. Number three, start a blog. Practice. Now you can start a blog. You might want to show some of your artwork on your blog. You might even want to just start an Insta account. You have to start something. Put up your art somewhere. Start practicing. Take pictures. Make an artwork. Make a sculpture. Do pottery. Practice. Do something to make sure that your creative juices keep flowing and you keep getting better. Excellence is a habit. Every time you do it, you get better at it. Excellence is a habit. Keep yourself in the habit of making your creative juices flow and you will get better as an artist every single time. Number four, design thinking. Now, this is a new one if you want to be a part of the design end of things. Now, I have a course. I think it's given by Stanford or MIT. I'll link it in the description. Take a look at it. It's an online course. It's a free course about how you should be thinking about design and how you can take a look at the next steps of making revolutionary artwork, revolutionary products to make the next best technology and the next best set of products come to life. I would highly encourage you to start here. This is where you learn product design. This is where you learn design of all sorts. This is where you learn to think about how to design things. I cannot recommend this course highly enough, and I think it is a great place for you to start. And that's it. That's my spiel about art. Thank you very much for listening, and I'll see you guys in the next episode.